Thank you. So I have a question for you. Do you know this machine here? This one? Who knows this? Yeah, most of you. Cool. It's a good old Commodore 64, the hero of my childhood. And it was released in 1982, and that really shows that I'm growing old nowadays. And it had about 1 megahertz, which is nothing compared to today's capacities. There was 64 kilobytes of main memory, and the floppy disks could store 170 kilobytes. And no one knows, but there has also been a dual core version of it, a version with 2 CPU cores, and it looked like this. And of course, the biggest challenge back then was about resources. You had to think twice before you used a big integer. You had to even think twice before you used an ordinary integer. Perhaps a tiny integer was enough, or just a fraction of a tiny integer. And the same was true for CPU cycles. So the biggest challenge was resources. Nowadays, resources is not a big issue anymore. Nowadays, the biggest issue is about complexity. Complexity because systems are getting bigger and bigger, and somehow we have to deal with all the functionality in there. And also, we have to deal with the different teams. Nowadays, we have a bunch of teams we have to coordinate. And in addition to that, we have to take care about long-time maintainability. A typical business software, or also industrial software, has to be extended and maintained for several decades, 10 or 20 years, or even more decades. And then, of course, there is this issue with milk products. Perhaps you are aware of it. There are milk products out there lasting longer than some JavaScript framework. So it was at a training about 2 months ago, and there was a guy, and he said to the other one, what you are using there in your team is so much 2015. So just do the math. 2015, it's just 4 years, and someone is finger pointing to you for using something that was quite a nice technology back then. So somehow it's wrong here, and we need a remedy. And this is exactly what this talk is about. In this talk, I will show you 2 remedies for this dilemma. The first remedy is about using web components. And the second one is about micro apps. And of course, in the end, I have prepared a little demonstration for you that shows how to use this stuff in production. But before we start, let me also introduce myself. I am Manfred. I'm a trainer and consultant. I'm focusing on Angular. I'm doing a lot of trainings as well as in-house consultancy here in Germany, but also in Austria. And I'm part of the Google Developer Expert Team. Since some weeks, I'm also a collaborator for Angular. And in this role, I'm preparing some new features for the upcoming Angular CLI. My current product is also about Angular. It's a workshop about Angular in the enterprise, and it contains a lot of advanced scenarios. You can book it as an in-house workshop as well as a public one. Now let's come to the first big remedy I've prepared. Let's talk about web components. As you might know, web components are just framework-independent components. That means you write a web component with one framework or with Vanilla.js, and you can use it with another framework or even with Vanilla.js. So somehow we have here the promise of Java, you know, write once and debug anywhere. No, I think it was run anywhere. And one nice byproduct here is that web components can very, very easily be lazy loaded. Lazy loading has never been that simple as with web components. But the big truth is that there is not a thing like a web component, because web components is just an umbrella term for a bunch of standards that can be used together to provide framework agnostic things. And here you see the official logos of those standards. The first logo is about templates. I think I don't need to talk much about templates. We all know templates, and we all can imagine something like a big HTML template with placeholders that are replaced with some serious stuff that shall be displayed to the user. The second logo here is about HTML imports. It is a means to import something from another HTML file, and this something might be a web component. The third thing is about custom elements. If you ask me, this is the most important standard here. Custom elements gives you a way to provide own HTML elements. Own HTML elements that are processed by the browser, and hence they are framework agnostic. And then there is Shadow Dome. I really like to pronounce it in German or to use the German expression, which would be Schattendom. It really sounds mighty in German. Just try to say Schattendom at your next meeting. Everyone will think you are a mighty person. And it is also a mighty standard because this Shadow Dome allows you to decouple your element from the rest of the dome. So your element can be rendered separately and then it is put into your traditional dome. And that means that a CSS file for your component does not affect the rest of the application. I think we all know those situations where you have two CSS files and where you try to use them together. And in the moment where you use them together, hell breaks loose. This exactly situation is avoided by Schattendom. So the nice thing is that we can immediately forget about HTML imports. They will not be a thing. The browser vendors agreed upon not implementing it because they said, hey, we have something like this. We already have ECMAScript imports. You use them with ECMAScript 2050 and upwards, or also with TypeScript, those import statements on top of your file. The first thing I'm getting asked when I'm talking about this in the enterprise environment is, does this thing work together with IE? So, as you might know, IE is still a big thing in the enterprise environment because of policies in all those companies out there. And yes, the answer is you can use it together with IE. There are polyfills. Of course, they are not perfect, and of course, you have to arrange yourself with those polyfills. But when you do this and when you start to test early with IE, most of the things should work. When you look at the API of custom elements, you see it is really drop-dead simple. It is just a matter of subclassing HTML element, and then within your constructor, you can create a shadow dome. And within the shadow dome, you can assign elements. Here I'm just using inner HTML for the sake of simplicity. It is not the most performant way to provide some tags, but it is simple and the best for getting started. A custom element is nothing more than this, just subclass HTML element, and then you have to register it with the browser. For this, you have to assign a tag name and your class, and that's it. After that, you can import your bundle, and then you can use your element, and the browser will take care about it. So, as you have seen here, using custom elements is quite simple in theory. But in practice, you have to take care about data binding, about updating the view, and about other things like testability, dependency injection, and so on and so forth. And that's why I'm really happy that there are a lot of additional frameworks out there that help to get started with custom elements. For instance, in the world of Angular, we have something called Angular Elements for about a year. Angular Elements is just a wrapper. It takes your ordinary Angular component, it wraps it, and it exposes everything as a web component for the browser. Or when you're looking into the Vue world, you can use the Vue CLI to compile an ordinary Vue component down to a web component. When it comes to React, I don't have such a nice message for you, but in React, you can wrap your React component by hand. just use the API you have seen before. And in the middle of the constructor, you could bootstrap a React component, or there are also community solutions to do this. That means more or less, regardless which framework you are using, you can use web components. So as mentioned before, web components is the first thing I want to talk about. The second thing that allows you to provide something like long-term maintainability are micro apps. And also here, the idea is quite simple. The idea is to not write a big system that can do everything. Because when you have a big system, it becomes really difficult to maintain. You change something here and you break something there. I guess you know this situation. And this is especially true when there are several teams involved. Let's say several UI teams. Because in this situation, they have to talk with each other. Talk with each other. No, just kidding. Talking with each other, communication is vital. But such a setting can also lead to a situation where the first team blocks the second team, where the second team cannot start implementing or cannot deploy something because they have to wait for the other teams. And this takes out a lot of agility. A lot of agility, flexibility, and so on. And in addition to that, you just have one framework and one architecture because you just have one system and both is hard to change. If you try to change your framework, if you try to change your architecture, you're ending up with a Frankenstein monster you don't want to have. And when you think about long-term maintainability, this is vital because no one knows what we will have in 5 years. Perhaps in 5 years there is a use case that needs a completely different framework or a completely different architecture style. So having the possibility to change everything in time would be quite nice. And this is exactly where micro apps come in. This idea is to just subdivide a big system into tiny, autarkic, self-contained parts. The idea is everything but new. But since several years, people in the back end are using it quite heavily. They are calling it microservices. If you would take this idea into the world of front-end development, you could call it micro front-ends or micro apps. But at the end of the day, it is the same. It's about creating several tiny pieces that don't need to know about each other that can be written in an autarkic way. And of course, this brings a lot of advantages. You can do a separate deployment. You can also use different technologies. Each of those micro apps can have its own technology stack, the technology stack that fits best for the current needs. You have less coordination among teams, and you have less complexity because you have smaller applications. Of course, there is nothing that just comes with advantages. One disadvantage here is that you're ending up with a highly distributed system and with distributed data. Each of those applications can have its own database because they are self-contained applications. And you have to deal with UI composition. UI composition means that you have to present everything as a big common thing to the user. We are happy to have 50 tiny, less complex applications. The user is not. The user is not interested in starting 50 applications every morning, and so we need to present everything as a common thing to him or to her. And this is something we need to deal with in the UI layer. I think the name UI composition says all. Everything else can be solved more or less in the backend. So when you think about composing everything, one very simple approach might be using hyperlinks. Hyperlinks are quite major, if you ask me. They are around for about 30 years now. The World Wide Web is now 30 years old. And I think it's quite a major technology because I have never, ever heard someone to say a bad word about hyperlinks. So it really seems to work. And in this very scenario, you would end up writing several tiny single-page applications connected to each other by means of hyperlinks. And I know this sounds somehow awkward, but for some kinds of applications, this is the right solution. Especially for product suites like the Google Suite or Office 365. When you look at the Google Suite, you have something like Google Maps here. It is specialized into one use case, namely working with maps and routes. And if you want to switch to another application, just follow a hyperlink here. By the way, this slide here shows the most important aspect of this whole presentation. I'm putting a lot of emphasis into it. If you forget everything, please always remember this tiny aspect. It is very, very vital. Namely, here in Germany, to be more precise, in Lower Saxony, there is a village called Steierberg. Yeah, I'm very proud of it. They have my name in it, and they write it in the right way. I am stressing this, and please never forget this. Is here someone from Lower Saxony, from Niedersachsen? Yeah, I love you people. Thank you. You are the best. Thank you. So let's go on with the boring technical stuff. The advantage of using hyperlinks is it is drop-dead simple, but you will lose your state when transitioning over to another application. And you also have to load new single-page applications when you follow a hyperlink. And this is exactly what we wanted to prevent when we invented single-page applications, didn't we? Also, you have to take care about UI consistency. For instance, you would like that this widget here looks the same in every separate single-page application. And this is where the cycle closes for the first time, because for this you could use web components. So you can use each technology you want in each of those micro apps, and then you can reuse your widget with them. Sometimes our users deserve better than just following hyperlinks, and in those situations you might come up with a shell architecture. A shell which is a single-page application capable of loading other single-page applications. What do you think? What is the most easiest aspect for writing an application that is capable of loading other applications? Which HTML element we could use for this? What do you think? You said iframe, didn't you? Yeah, iframes, yeah. I don't know about you, but I'm always getting this strange feeling in the stomach when I'm hearing the word iframe. But sometimes it's the right solution, because an iframe provides a heavy amount of isolation. That means one iframe cannot hack another iframe, which is vital when you have to integrate several applications from several vendors. Also, a bug here does not influence the functionality there. Another approach is bootstrapping several single-page applications, which means you have one index HTML, and there you load several single-page applications. An Angular application, a Vue application, a React application, and so on and so forth. When you do so, I would suggest to wrap everything into web components. To wrap every micro app into web components. Now you have very coarse-grained web components, but this comes with a big advantage. Namely, you have a unified API for the shell. The shell does not need to know, hey, you are written with Angular, and hence I have to talk with you that way, and you are a React application, and so I have to talk with you that way. You just have a unified API that provides properties and events, and so you have a unified way for communication. Micro apps and web components also allow to nest everything. That means you can use an Angular component in the middle of a React component, which you are using in the middle of a Vue component. When you are doing so, I would advise you to separate two layers. The first layer is what I'm calling the macro architecture. It's about holding everything together. It's about the glue between your micro apps. And the second layer is the layer with shared widgets. I'm calling it the widgets layer or the micro architecture. I would advise to separate those two layers because you can come up with completely different solutions for each of them. At the layer of the macro architecture, you could use hyperlinks, you could use web components, you could use several single page applications or iframes. And at the layer for the widgets, you could also use web components, but also NPM packages or something like this. So I think enough theory. Let me show you a demonstration for this. In this demonstration, I have a shell application. And when I'm clicking here, I'm loading an Angular application. And there, I'm also loading an Angular application. Those are separate applications, applications that can be developed separately, tested separately, and deployed separately. You can even start them in standalone mode, as you see here. And the shell just loads those applications as web components and displays them. Here I also have a few components to show that we can mix and match different technologies. And here I have a legacy application, an AngularJS application. This also shows that you can use this to move away from legacy technologies. This is the macro architecture. And in addition to that, I have a micro layer here. Here you see I can reuse widgets from other clients for the sake of UI integration in the middle of my red Angular client. Sometimes this is necessary to just bridge several use cases. Sometimes several use cases belong together. Okay, now we have seen several approaches for providing micro apps with JavaScript technologies. And now, of course, the question is, which is the right solution for our current needs? And to be honest, this question is very difficult to answer because each of them has some advantages and some disadvantages. And if you are honest, every one of us just wants to have the advantages. This is why I turned up in cycles when discussing this with my customers. And so I had an idea. One day I came up with a decision tree for those solutions. And of course, the decision tree cannot be the last word on this, but it proved to be handy several times. The first question I would ask you here is, do you have a lot of shared state? And do you have to navigate a lot between your micro apps? If you say no, then chances are high that you are best with hyperlinks. In this case, you have different self-contained applications and you can integrate them with hyperlinks. If you say, oh yes, there is a lot of shared state, and if you say, yes, I have a lot of navigation between my micro app, the next question is, do you have to integrate legacy applications or do you need a very, very strong isolation? And if you say yes, then go with iframes. Saying this, you will not write the next Amazon with iframes. It is not a good fit, as you know, for public websites, but it is quite okay-ish for intranet-style applications. If you say no, we don't have legacy, we are starting on the green field, then the next question is, do you even need a separate deployment? Do you even have several UI teams? Do you even need a mix of technologies? And when you say yes, then bootstrap several single page applications. If you say no, then go with a mono repository, a big application that is subdivided using libraries into tinier parts, which is more a traditional way. The best thing here is that everywhere here, we can make use of web components. Okay, let me come to a conclusion. We have seen that web components help us to decouple from a current framework, and we have also seen that micro apps help us with decoupling between teams and projects. You have self-contained and autarkic teams that can do their own decisions. We have seen that we can combine web components and micro apps and something beautiful will happen. And we have seen that using this approach, every one of us can use the best technologies for your current project. So that's it from me. Thanks for coming. Here you have my contact data. Have a nice day. And if you want, follow me on Twitter so that we can keep in contact. Thank you. Have a nice conference.